Let's imagine we enter an antique bookstore. Hundreds of severe-looking volumes all lined up on the shelves. They have leather covers, red or dark green. Let's look carefully. In a corner, all dusty, there's a very long row of huge volumes. Almost 100 books with thousands of pages full of figures. The title is written in golden letters. History of Life on Earth, from its beginnings until today. The first volumes tell of when our planet, 4.5 billion years ago, was very different from what it is now, with continuous earthquakes and erupting volcanoes. Then, some talk about the first living forms and their evolution. Here, there is one that tells the story of the dinosaurs, the giant animals that populated the Earth for 160 million years and then disappeared forever. Well, only the last of these volumes tell the story of our species, and describes the life of our ancient ancestors, which began in a period so far away that it's hard to even think about it, millions of years ago. Let's try to leaf through it slowly and read about the history of man before the chronicles that followed the invention of writing, a journey that begins a few million years ago, at a time when the hominids had already detached themselves from the other primates, but were still hiding in the African forests, until... Due to the desertification of Africa about 3 million years ago, forests began to give way to savanna, and only a few of the already sparse groups of hominids were able to adapt to this change. The largest and most successful group in adapting was the so-called Australopithecines, who tried to survive in the regions that are now part of South Africa and Ethiopia. These hominids were short in stature, and their bodies were almost entirely covered with hair. Their skulls were smaller than those of modern humans, and they had large, strong teeth, although they fed mostly on vegetables. It made them different from apes that they had already adopted the upright posture and used their hands only to pick up, pull, break, or bring to their mouth the things they found. The most famous Australopithecus is called Lucy, or better, so was called by the anthropologist who discovered her almost complete fossil skeleton. It was a female of small stature, about 1 meter and 10 centimeters high, who lived in Ethiopia 3.2 million years ago. Australopithecines, between species, pulled through for a couple of million years, then became extinct, leaving the territory to a species with which they had coexisted with over the last period. If we quickly leaf through the pages of our volume, up to 1.5 million years ago, we find, in fact, the story of a boy who lived in Africa near Lake Turkana, in present-day Kenya. He was about 11 years old and was tall, almost like us, with long legs and narrow hips. His body had almost completely lost its ape-like characteristics. Anthropologists who found his bones have determined that it was a new species, which they called Homo erectus. At about the same time, some groups of erectus left their territory and began a journey that would take them to other areas of North Africa, Europe, and Asia. Because survival in the snowy forests of Northern Europe required different qualities than those needed to survive in the humid jungles of Indonesia, populations of humans evolved in different directions. The result was the production of many distinct species, each of which scientists assigned a pompous Latin name. In Europe and Western Asia, humans evolved into Neanderthal man, who was more massive and muscular than the erectus and was better adapted to the cold climate. The Neanderthals knew how to build weapons of stone, wood, and bone, and also had their own culture since they buried their dead. However, traces of their existence disappeared around 30,000 years ago, and this is still a great mystery. What is it that in less than 50,000 years brought the Neanderthals to extinction? Well, the fact is that Africa continued to produce more and more sophisticated human species, and that in successive waves. About 100,000 years ago, in the Middle East and then in Europe, a species appeared, ours, which we have very modestly classified as Homo sapiens, a man anatomically indistinguishable from what we are now. In Europe, the sapiens will live with the Neanderthals for thousands of years, but then the latter will disappear, and our species, from then on, will become the only representative of the genus Homo, on our planet? Was there between Sapiens and Neanderthal a peaceful assimilation or a genocide? We don't know. But what is certain is that as soon as the Sapiens arrived in a new territory, the native population, after a while, became extinct. The last remains of some subspecies of Homo erectus are dated to about 50,000 years ago. Homo Denisova disappeared shortly thereafter. Neanderthals left the scene approximately 30,000 years ago. The last gnome-like humans on Flores Island disappeared about 12,000 years ago. They left behind a few bones, a few tools, a few genes that also belong to our DNA, and a huge amount of unanswered questions. And they left us sapiens alone. To what did we owe the success of the sapiens? How could we settle so quickly in so many distinct and ecologically diverse habitats? How did we relegate all other human species to oblivion? Why did not even the strong, intelligent, and hardened Neanderthals survive our furious onslaught? The debate continues to be heated. The most likely answer is precisely the one that makes the debate possible. Homo sapiens conquered the world, thanks above all to its extraordinarily ductile and complex language. Not that the sapiens were doing very well. At the time of their invasion, a great frost enveloped Europe. Men and women found refuge in natural caves dug by the water. The communities were small, consisting of a few dozen people who helped each other and defended themselves together from animals or enemy groups. Due to the cold, disease, and hardships of that era, most children died within the first few months of life. But even the average lifespan of adults barely reached 30 years. To find food, females gathered wild fruits, and males captured small animals and probably brought home those they found already dead. Their weapons were rudimentary, but effective. Wooden sticks, stone-tipped spears, sharp stones to hurl at animals with a kind of slingshot. Then, over thousands of years, the climate changed. The ice melted, and herds of oxen and horses began to graze on the verdant plains. Small tribes could now live outside the caves and move about the land, chasing wild herds. Sometimes they returned with animals, season after season, to the places from which they had departed, finding safe places each spring to give birth and feed their young. With time, however, men became very skilled in building objects of stone. In the beginning, primitive peoples were probably content to use sharp stones gathered along the way or the broken bones of dead animals. Then, over the course of thousands of years, someone realized that the splinters could be built and shaped into different forms according to the use they wanted to make of them. Particularly hard pebbles of flint or lava were used, the same stones that, when beaten hard, made sparks for fire. The ability to make sharp stone chips allowed, over time, to build more elaborate hunting tools, combining different materials, stone, horn, and wood to make spears and harpoons, wood and leather to make bows, and so on. Precisely because of the ability of the ancients to work stone, this prehistoric period has been called Paleolithic, which means Ancient Stone Age. A period that saw not only blood and suffering, but also the birth of the first artistic expressions of humanity. Already 20,000 years ago, in fact, men had begun to paint animals and hunting scenes on the walls of the caves. Extraordinary paintings of 17,000 years ago were discovered in 1940 in the cave of Lascaux in France, where there are figures of bulls with long pointed horns, powerful horses portrayed in profile or in front, deer, ibexes, and several felines painted in the colors of the earth, black, yellow ochre, red, brown. Other paintings dating back 15,000 years have been found on the walls of the Altamira cave. They were probably artistic representations aimed at auspicious rituals for hunting expeditions. At the time, in fact, everything still depended on the good outcome of the hunting activity, not only for food. The skins of the captured and killed beasts were used to cover themselves and to build temporary tents to be used until the next displacement. In this way, the populations were less tied to the shelters found among the rocks, and they could live as nomads, traveling for long distances in search of water and nourishment without ever going back, living off what they found each time. All this until the end of the Paleolithic and the beginning of the Neolithic, which means New Stone Age, about 12,000 years ago, when there was the change that would shape forever the life of human beings and the entire planet, the spread of agriculture. Some small tribes learned to produce their own food without having to go and look for it in distant places. They began to cultivate near the villages the most useful plants for food. People who were previously nomadic began to stay in one place for longer and longer periods. To live near the fields, they built stone houses, more solid and destined to accommodate the whole family for long years. The first plants cultivated were cereals such as barley, millet and wheat, because they grew quickly and were very productive. They also exploited roots and tubers such as cassava and legumes such as peas, lentils and broad beans. In some excavations, there's also been found seeds of poppy and flax, two plants from which it was possible to obtain oil or fiber for fabrics. To cultivate the fields, many human groups fixed their dwellings in suitable places, building stable camps. Life was a little less adventurous, but they could build and store bulky tools to be used at the appropriate time. For example, this period dated back to the first looms, which allow you to weave plant fibers to make fabrics, much softer and more comfortable than animal skins. The vases of clay no longer ran the risk of breaking during long displacements, and they built very large, solid, and well-decorated containers suitable to hold water or to store food. Probably the most ancient populations of farmers lived in the highlands of the Middle East, regions at that time very fertile. In areas bearing traces of cultivation, deposits of cultivated barley and wheat have been found, as well as stone agricultural tools such as hoes and sickles, which appear to date from about 10,000 years ago. Other traces of agricultural work have been found in China and India, where rice was already being grown 9,000 years ago, and in the Americas, where corn and potatoes were grown 8,000 years ago. This means that the practice of agriculture slowly spread over millennia from Middle Eastern territories throughout the planet. Once they became sedentary, Neolithic peoples also understood that animals could be domesticated, that is, captured, bred, and used as a source of food or skin, to carry heavy loads, or to guard, or even to keep company. We now know that the region where this, necessary at the time but cruel and barbaric in our days, practice began was Central Asia. Here in the wild, many species could be useful for feeding. Sheep, goats, wild boar, and aurochs, a type of wild ox that has now disappeared, the ancestor of today's oxen. The dog was domesticated between 20,000 and 30,000 years ago, still in the Paleolithic period, a period to which many remains of canine bones were found in the villages of various populations in Europe and the Near East. Sheep were domesticated in Western Asia nearly 11,000 years ago, when goats began to be raised in Anatolia and Iran. In later millennia, flocks of sheep and goats were also found in Europe. Other animals such as the horse, donkey, camel, dromedary, buffalo and cat were domesticated much later in different regions of Europe and Asia. Each species was chosen for particular useful characteristics. Sheep for their milk and soft fur, horses for their resistance in carrying loads, or for their speed in running. The villages became larger and larger. In the tribe, each carried out his job. They exchanged and traded goods and formed the first social classes. The villages were not far from each other and usually built near waterways, so it was possible to irrigate the cultivated fields and give drink to the animals enclosed in the pens. Men and women of the different groups had frequent contact and exchanged useful objects and products. Vases in exchange for daggers, cereal seeds in exchange for goat's milk, starting to practice a primitive form of trade. At this time, the different peoples had already established rules and agreements to divide the territory and avoid conflict. They were governed by leaders respected by all. They were socially organized and had sacred places in which to carry out religious practices. There were wise men who knew how to interpret the natural manifestations of heaven and earth, and therefore had a role of great prestige. The warriors, the hunters, the farmers, the blacksmiths, and the potters now belonged to different social classes. It is possible to understand this by studying how the dead were buried. The graves of warriors, in general, are rich in weapons and finely crafted objects, and suggest an important position in society, while the graves of people who did the most menial jobs are unadorned, with few stone objects. In addition to these groups of villages, however, complex urban structures were also built. One of the first large cities of which traces are preserved is Jericho in the current West Bank, whose development dates back to over 8,000 years ago. It was surrounded by walls to defend against the incursions of nomadic peoples and was inhabited by almost 2,000 people. To us, it may seem like a very small city, but for those times, it was a real metropolis. Here, the book we have just finished leafing through closes with the invention of writing. Since the populations of Mesopotamia more than 5,000 years ago began to draw on clay tablets signs to communicate, a new phase of history has opened, the one that is reconstructed by scholars also on the basis of written documents. All that we know, all we think we know, about prehistory, we had to look for among the stones, in the excavations conducted by paleontologists and archaeologists. But from then on, the invention of writing has allowed us to know the development of history thanks to the direct testimony of those who lived before us. Thus, knowledge has been able to benefit not only from our contemporaries, but also from the much larger number of wise men of all times.